just behind you and tell them there's some destruction going on. Cause this is your year. Well, what God uses here is a lamb, a lamb. He uses something basic, something innocent, something that's not ferocious, something who appears to be nothing more than a humble essence of what life has to offer. He doesn't use horns, and he doesn't use a violent beast. It doesn't have a roar. It doesn't have big feet. It doesn't have anything to protect it. It doesn't have scales. It doesn't have a shield. He uses a lamb. And he said, put a lamb in every house and change the structure of the decor on the outside of the house. Take the blood of a lamb and put it on the doorpost and the lintel, and make sure that everybody that does this knows that when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. Sisters and brothers, you've got to see what God is doing. He's not going to come back and die again, but you and I are going to be the lamb in the house this time. It said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you would present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And when God sees the blood, he's going to pass over you. And when it's time, like now, we're coming out by nations. Hold households, we're stepping out of here. Sisters and brothers, you must do this one in haste. You can't sit at the table talking about I'm taking my shoes off. You gotta be fully dressed and ready to go. Ready to leave your past. Ready to step into the future things of God. Sisters and brothers, you forgive me here, but I'm trying to stay with this clock. And I need to talk fastly here. So, sisters and mothers, I want you to see them eating their bread with no yeast, eating their bread with haste, with their full garments on. It'd be all right if we were at 6 o'clock dinner time, but this is midnight, and a strange, foolish calling together of a midnight supper, a supper at midnight. Most of us go to dinner at 4 and 5, but this is a dinner for the nation, a dinner for the kingdom, a dinner that brings divine release. And God calls supper at midnight. He said, when I come through here, when I see the blood, me and death will pass over. When midnight came, they were eating in haste, eating bitter herbs so that they could remember how to forget. God put the taste in their taste buds, put the bitterness all in their mouth, so that they'd have an appetite for better, so they'd have an appetite for sweet, so they'd have an appetite for, I want some rest, I want a better life, I want a better day. God put the bitterness in their mouth so they could taste it thoroughly, like connoisseurs, and remember the pain, because God was taking them to a better land. But sometimes we can't appreciate the better until we remember how bitter it's really been. God brings about the bitter so that they'll have a taste for the sweet. And at midnight he goes riding, walking through the city, riding on the shoulders of death. Everywhere death said, what about here? No. You see? Don't you see the decor has been changed? They got blood on the door. I told them I'd pass over. What about this house? No. It's not as straight as the last house, but the blood's there. Come on, let's go around the corner. What about here? No. I see some blood here. It's dripping. It's smelly. It stinks. But let's keep on moving. Well, in the land of Goshen, it smells like a slaughterhouse. Did you mean this? Yeah, I meant that. It stinks. It stinks everywhere. The blood stinks. It stinks. It's a profuse smelly smell. I feel like I'm about said, no, 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 son. That's perfume. I want you to understand that blood is covering sins. Sins of the fathers. Sins of the forefathers. But when I see it, it smells like perfume. Chanel number 5. That's my number. I like the way that smells. That means somebody's ready for a change. Somebody's ready for transformation. Somebody's ready to get out of here. Somebody's ready to go forward. When I see the blood, I'll pass over. Look at somebody and say, that's me. I'm a bloody mess. I'm a slaughterhouse. I repent every day. Shout hallelujah. Shout glory. Put your hands together and give God praise. Sisters and brothers, please recognize this fact. By time midnight was finished, there's a call in chapter 12, verse number 31. Go wake up Moses and Aaron. Get them up out of the bed. Tell them, come here quickly. Get all your stuff and get out. Get your children and get out. Your wives and get out. Get your stuff and get out of here. We don't want you here. Oh, what's wrong now? You've been here with us for 430 years, but now all of a sudden you want me out. He said, don't even wait till the morning. Get out now. When the fullness of time comes, you won't have time to pack a bag. You gotta listen to God right now and prepare to get out. Get your mind ready to get out. Get your spirit ready to get out. Most of the times we don't hover over stuff. When God speaks a prophetic word, what we do is write it down and forget it before we leave here. What you got to know how to do is hover over that word in the Holy Spirit, and it will bring forth what you need to happen in your life. Sisters and brothers, Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form in a chaotic position. And the Spirit of the Lord brooded over that thing. Brooded over that mess. Brooded over that chaotic situation. Fluttered and hovered. Calculated and decided. Something can happen out of this. Something great can happen out of this. And then God said, let it be. What is God saying? He's saying amen to what his spirit has already investigated. When God speaks a divine word to you, brood over that thing. Oh yeah, 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 God. I need this to happen in my life more now than ever. I need this permanent change. I don't need a quick fix for a convention. I don't need a conference fix. I don't need a seminar fix. I need a permanent, radical, militant change to happen in my life. I'm not going home the same way I came. I'm going home emphatically, totally, radically different than I've ever been in my life. My thinking's got to change. I'm putting down my thoughts that would interrupt this happening in my life. I'm setting aside my ways that would bring about an eclipse on your word taking form in my life. I'm stepping away from every mountain that would impede my step forward, and I'm gonna step back in this thing and run in it all my might. Shout hallelujah. Shout glory. Sisters and brothers, that night they're on their way out. Exodus chapter number 4 declares, Moses, before we got to 12, they said, Moses, when they get ready to leave here, make sure they have reparations. Don't tell them bag. Don't tell them body heads. Don't tell them do none of that foolish stuff. But sisters and brothers, I want you to understand something real clear. I want you to understand it very plainly. Tell them take everything. Take everything. It was owed to them for 430 years. You don't have to bow for it. You don't have to beg for it. It's your time. You don't have to plead for it. Why? Chapter 4 said, I'm giving you favor. I'm going to step in this thing with you. It's your time. You're in your fullness now. You were getting just a little this and that. No, no, no. The fullness of time. The fullness of his grace. The fullness of his favor brings about something totally different. You're going to get stuff your forefathers should have got, but didn't get because they were under a broken window. You gonna get stuff your great matriarchal mothers in Zion should have got, but couldn't get because the laws were changed, the system was against them, the time stood up like a mountain. We're in a new